granted the salute to the flag in executive session. And if you all have copies of your agenda, there's a statement of public notice. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but just want to remind you you're going to have two opportunities to address the board tonight. At the first time, you may address the board on any agenda items. During the second public comment session, you can address the board on anything you care to discuss with us. When you come up, don't forget to please sign in, state your name and address, and limit your comments. With that, we're going to start our meeting with a student representative report. I'd like to welcome Rachel Breslow, who is treasurer of the student body, student council, who is representing them tonight. Thank you for your time this evening. We will extend the same invitation to you as we've done to student representatives over the year. If you have homework, please go home and do it. You don't have to stay with us. Thanks so much. All right. Next, we have the superintendent's report. So it looks like there is one item for motion. May I have a motion for item number one? Mrs. Richmond, may I have a second? Mrs. Woolbridge? Mr. Mark Aaron?
So these are the annual list of overnight trips for the request to the YMCA team, and of course, because of overnight events, the new teams were approved.
All right, may we have a roll call, please?
Mr. Byrne?
Yes.
Mrs. Horner?
Yes.
Mrs. Gray?
Yes.
Dr. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Fry?
Yes.
Yes. Mrs. Shaw?
Yes.
Mrs. Wolver?
Yes.
Mrs. McKean?
Yes.
Madam President?
Thank you, Mr. Markarian. Do you have anything else for your report?
Yes. Yes, I do. Thank you very much. So, welcome to the 2016-17 school year. I just wanted to share a little bit with you about our opening. We had a report last year on September 15th of our enrollment at that time, so I compared that enrollment report to where we stood as of today. It's always nice to see how things are going from one year to the next. So just to share a little bit with you high school is almost identical. Last year and this year, we have two additional students. We're at 1903 this year. Last year, we opened at 1901. And finally, at William Adam Middle School, last year, we opened at 1398, and today, we are at 1364. So we're down 34 students at William Adam. So our total enrollment on September 15th of 2015 was 5,641. And as of today, we are at 5,529 for a difference of 112 students. And we had anticipated around 100 students less for this year. So it's about what we expected to be down 112 students. I also wanted to share with you a couple of other things in case you missed it over the summer. Mr. McLaughlin gave us a report on our summer projects, and I just wanted to just highlight for you in case you visit the schools at our back to school nights over the next couple of weeks. Liberty Corner School received an air conditioning project. In fact, a new HVAC system was installed. Mr. McLaughlin reported out on that over the summer, last month actually. The varsity softball field for the girls was redone over the summer. And security enhancements were added at the entrances of each of the elementary schools, which you may notice when you visit the elementary schools. We're waiting on a little bit of glass to finish some windows there, but hopefully they'll be installed before the back of the school night. So keep my fingers crossed on that. And I do want to highlight the fact that I've been reminded several times, acutely in fact, that Oak Street School is still looking to get air conditioning, as is many sections of William Adam Middle School. And I just wanted to let folks know that we are committed to going back out to bid for air conditioning at Oak Street School. And we anticipate having those bid documents out next month in October. And that, remember, is part of a grant project, a regular operating district grant project that would be funded 40% by the state. As for the William Adam air conditioning, which we don't anticipate for next summer, probably the summer after. So our goal is to have the air conditioning project, which is really heating and air conditioning at Oak Street School for summer of 2017. As I said, we should be out to bid for that in October. Lastly, something else that I've seen as an ongoing issue since roughly this time last year, we started to talk about our busing situation, and we've been talking about different solutions. We looked at changing schedules and tiering our buses, and ultimately, we came down to trying to maintain the existing schedules and try to be more efficient to meet the need of a higher cost service in transportation. And the way that we did that was, the way that we accomplished that, I should say, was with some route consolidation. So the timing wasn't terrible, given that we're down 112 students. That certainly helps us as we are consolidating routes. And ultimately, what that allows me to do is to be more efficient. And as we talked about during the budget season, it'll create some ripples. There'll be some changes, and certainly having more students on a given bus is what consolidation means, and therefore there is the possibility that a route could potentially be a little longer if in fact you're putting more students on the bus and you're adding stops. That could be a concern. So obviously that's something that we've been monitoring, and I have to thank Mr. McLaughlin for working so closely with the transportation office, keeping tabs on these issues. I want to tell you that I think that we did a very good job. I know that it's not perfect, and I know that there are some issues that have come to both the transportation office from Somerset County Educational Services that handles our transportation, and also issues that have arisen and come to either the schools or ultimately to the business office that Mr. McLaughlin heads, and that he has been keeping a list of all of these issues, knowing that the opening of school is a challenging time. You're adding students, you're dropping students, you're getting last-minute requests for subscription busing, you're getting people who are registering at the last minute, and of course, everybody would like things right away, which is understandable. They want to get their transportation issues taken care of. But our policy is really that last-minute requests don't get processed until the middle of September. So truthfully, it isn't until October or even into October before all the adjustments are settled down. I just want to point out that this is not a new thing. Regardless of bus consolidation, this happens every year. And the first 4 or 5 weeks of school, we deal with all the transportation challenges to try to smooth things out to the best of our ability. When we do that, there are a few things that we have to take into consideration. First and foremost is that we have a seat for students on the bus. And that means that if it's a 54-passenger bus, we don't have more than 54 students assigned to a bus. So obviously that's a safety consideration, and as we go through the first few weeks of school, safety is the top priority, but addressing transportation needs to want to make sure that we address those safety issues first. So we take a look at safety concerns that have come up, maybe with the location of a bus stop, try to address those first. The number of students assigned to the bus, try to address those first. And then finally, we are obligated by law to provide transportation for some students, depending on how far they live from school. So the third thing, in addition to the safety considerations, is that we have to make sure that everyone that's entitled to have a seat on a bus, by law, we provide that seat on the bus. So somebody that comes last minute looking for a subscription seat on a bus is going to have to take a back seat, if you will, to somebody who is looking to For somebody who's looking to add subscription busing is going to have to wait for somebody who might be entitled because they're remote from school to get a seat on the school bus. So those are the issues. We know that we have issues to resolve, and I've been meeting with Mr. McLaughlin and working with him, understanding what the issues are that he's maintaining on his list, and we're doing everything we can to get it smoothed out as quickly as possible. I did ask Mr. McLaughlin to take a few notes to share with the board with respect to what is he seeing relative to some of the fundamental basics of what occurred during the consolidation process. So I will sit by him for a few minutes and turn it over to him so that he can share some of that basic consolidation information with Mr. McLaughlin.
Let me just mention one piece before I get into some of the numbers here, which is that time en route actually has not changed. We did eliminate that's the status on the gen ed routes. The A, the special ed routes, only one route was eliminated, that was at Cedar Hill. And let me give you the data on that. So last year, Cedar Hill's average load on a bus for special ed routes, which were four routes last year, was 8 students per route. And the average time per route was 32 minutes. This year, you're down to a total of 30 students, and it's 10 students on three routes. And the average increase is 11 minutes per route. And other than that, we didn't eliminate any routes in special ed, so there's really no impact from consolidation.
Thank you, Mr. McLaughlin. Are there any questions from the board regarding this? Ms. Shaw?
So you could have an individual route that could go up by 17 minutes or down by as much, or so I've got one that goes up by 29 minutes, but you have to realize that some of these routes are only 15 or 20 minutes to begin with. So now that what you really have to think about is what's the longest route that we have out there.
Okay.
So the longest routes that we have out there, I'm just scanning this today.
have another bus and just drive it later, move back to the school, and have those kids out. We would have to get into that situation, but we've never had to do that.
Any other bus questions? So we're going to move on to public comment on agenda items. Now is the time to address the board on any of the items that are on the agenda. Please don't forget to sign in and state your name and address before addressing the board.
I'm Pat Crowell, the Rich High School PTO liaison to the board of that. I just have a clarification. There seems to be some confusion, and people are talking to me about it. You sent out the survey about the busing, and if you'd be willing to give up your seat, for example, I offered my son's seat to school, but then there wasn't really communication after that. I think some people are sort of confused, like, did they give up the seat? Did they not give up the seat? And I think what I just said on what you said a minute ago is that no one actually gave up any seats if they were entitled to them. Okay, that's my question.
advocacy met this morning, and I will report out at the next board meeting.
All right, liaison reports. I know Mrs. Woolridge has one for us.
Yes, I have a liaison report from the Municipal Alliance. We met on September 6th, and I just wanted to talk about a few things. One is the Municipal Alliance currently has openings for 3 citizen representatives. So, hopefully we'll get some interest from the community. We talked about it this morning at the PTO President's meeting about getting some publicity out. The Municipal Alliance back, I believe, in June applied for a $5,000 competitive grant and was successful. And the grant funds are going to be used for 8th grade programs, including an empowerment day at William Madden on October 21st. Which is along the lines of the Summit Day that used to be held, but it's going to be updated with new activities. We also had a meeting, we talked about the Lindsay Meyer Teen Institute, which took place in August. This is a 1-week summer program for high school students, and Burns Township had the largest 31 students. And the Burns Township group also won the LNTI Knowledge Award for the quality of their Ridge Against Alcohol and Drugs is a community-based group, mostly Ridge High School students. And this group has grown a lot in the past couple of years. 18 RAD members attended the Municipal Alliance meeting in September. The students talked about their experiences at the LMTI camp and their plans for the 2016-17 school year. They plan to focus on mental health and special needs, underage drinking, IDs, vaping, and coaches, athletes, and drug use. On October 27th, the Ridge Fall PTO meeting is hosting Ellen Patel, who's the clinical director at Dayton, New Jersey, and she'll be speaking on teens' emotional health, anxiety, and self-esteem. Dayton, New Jersey provides treatment for adolescents and adults with addiction, substance use, and associated issues. And finally, Municipal Alliance plans to administer drug and alcohol survey to grades 6, 8, 10, and 12 during the school year. Does anybody have any questions? Mr. Brent?
I just have 2 comments. The pro athlete came spoke.
Yes.
I think he's coming back.
Well, the community crisis group is working on trying to arrange that for the school year, most likely.
The other thing, I don't remember where I read it, the student-teacher survey on drugs and alcohol, I think they said it could have been a student survey at the end of the year. It's gotten worse. And so, I think the Municipal Alliance, as far as I'm concerned, has to push it a lot.
I'm not sure what's
How are you? My name is Heather Rodriguez. I have been a basketball student here. We love Oak Street School. We have 2 children there. We'd like to address you guys this evening. But we really want to talk about what was the air conditioner. So Andres, I know you guys are working with that, but for a couple of years, we had a teacher who did a fabulous job, but she had an AC. It was very difficult to concentrate. She picked them up almost every day and tried to find some location where they could concentrate. And it was such a problem. And now I have my second grader who's in a classroom, and in the past couple of days he's come home saying, "Mommy, it's so hot." This is my happy-go-lucky child that complains about nothing. He's asking me for a fan this afternoon, yet his teacher's telling him he can't have one. Last year, I quickly purchased one because the other parent was able to get one because their son had asthma, but the classroom was approved. So I offered to volunteer and pay for the next one. So I think my concern today is I hear that you guys do have, you know, a process in place to go out for bids. One of my questions would be regarding that bids. We've gone out for bids before, so what makes this time different? We also started a petition. We have a lot of parents who are very passionate. It has been very, very warm. We have over 250 signatures at this point in time, and I'd like to read one of the comments. It is outrageous to me that the Board of Education spent funds of updating high school softball fields this summer while continuing to ignore the AC issue at Oak Street School. The PTO redirects funds raised for AC to Chromebooks based on a BOE statement that AC would be installed this past summer. If the adults working at the BOE had to work in those conditions, they would shut down the office due to unhealthy work conditions. And by the way, there are BOE staff that work in the offices in the Oak Street building, and they have air conditioning.
So much for speaking to us because it's very brave of you. Not every student will come and speak to the board. Would it be okay to move this way a little bit so all the board members can see your face as you address us? All right, go ahead.
So, my teacher was Mrs. Bond, and every day I would be complaining to my mom that it was so hard in the classroom and it was so distracting, like when we would read on the road. It was so hot and it would be so distracting and it was really hard to concentrate and learn in the heat.
Thank you. That's good information for us to have.
So I think I would love, I don't know if you are willing to comment, but you know, the fact that you're going out to bid again, you know, what makes that different this year? What are their opportunities to improve?
Okay. And we will address the questions once we finish the public comment section of the agenda.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right. Are there any other public comments? Yes,
Thank you, Mrs. Werner.
You're welcome.
In all seriousness, we do recognize the issues and we do take the air quality room, whether it's heat, whether it's cold, you want to make sure that the space is as comfortable as you can make it. And we certainly recognize that that's not the case in all of our classrooms, and that's why we made a commitment to all of these ROD grants and the projects that we've submitted. We could have submitted for other things, but we made it a priority to submit for air quality and the comfort level in the classroom, because I do agree that to the extent that you can improve the educational environment and the comfort level for the staff and students, you should try to do that, because it does help. It helps people be more comfortable, it helps them focus, and I can appreciate that it's difficult to focus when you're really hot. I had a meeting in my office this morning that lasted 3 hours, and I was ready to run outside because it was really hot, and the air conditioning wasn't working. So I appreciate it, I get it, and I think we all understand how important it is. Unfortunately, when you are working in a school district and you're dealing with the public procurement process, it's not always a perfect system. I appreciate the comment, can we get monthly reports on a monthly basis? And I'd be more than happy to do that at every board meeting to let you know how things are going, and also to talk to Dr. Costa, so she can certainly let folks know at a school level. And the report for this month is that we're trying to get the bid for next month. Now, the good news about going to bid in October is that if the bidding process for some reason breaks down or fails and we're unable to award a contract, it's still there's still plenty of time in the school year that you can go back out to bid. So that is a situation where we're in a better position this time around than the last time around, because we're getting out there sooner. I certainly hope that that doesn't happen. Unfortunately, we can't guarantee that we will get what's known as a responsible bidder. And if you make a determination that the bidder's not responsible, then the contract doesn't necessarily get awarded. And if you have a valid reason for doing that, our attorney can certainly explain the details of that, but if you have a valid reason, you can certainly go back out to bid. Examples of things are the budget comes back too high, the contractor that bid has some failed documentation and not registered with the state. There's all kinds of problems that can happen, because there's a lot of intricacies in doing public work, and the licensing and certification alone can be cause to make someone who wants to do the work not qualified to do the work. So I wish I could promise that on any given public bid, we can guarantee that we're going to get someone responsible and that everything's going to be hunky-dory. But if you look at the history of any school district, you're going to see sometimes that projects take years to make happen in order to get things to work in a compliant way. And we do have to be compliant. So I'm certainly disappointed and sorry that we weren't able to take care of Oak Street this summer, but we're committed to try again, and we'll stay committed until we can get it to happen. And I'm sorry, but that's the best I can tell you at this time. And we certainly will be more than happy to give updates to both the full board, the public, as well as the school, Oak Street.
All right, so now we're on to board forum. We have one item on the agenda, and that's a meeting with Senator Kane. For those of you who aren't familiar with who he is the New Jersey Senate Minority Leader. He also happens to be the representative for our district, and his offices are located in Westfield. Mrs. Wooldridge and myself met with him and members of his staff about 4 years ago to just update him on relevant issues that impact our district. And I believe what we spoke about 4 years ago were how unfunded mandates were hurting our district, and the state had stopped telling us we had to do things that cost additional money that we didn't have in our budget since that meeting partners were there. So we had the opportunity to meet with him again. I believe we're meeting a week from tomorrow. And I would like to talk to the board about what issues and background information we should come armed with for this meeting coming up. And I can start.
Go for it. Okay. I mean, we've had a lot of discussions about the school funding formula. For those of you who aren't that familiar, there's a funding formula in New Jersey, and it hasn't been fully funded how many years now. So even if it's 6 years, thank God. So you can argue about whether or not it's a fair formula, which a lot of people might not think it is, but it's not even being funded the way it's supposed to be, and our district has been hurt by that, you know, lot over the last bunch of years. So one of the things that I know you're planning on addressing is our funding situation. There's a couple new proposals out there for funding. Governor Christie has one, Sweeney has one, there's a couple other ones out there. So it's kind of a hot topic now. But for towns like us that were already getting much less of our state aid than most other towns, to not even get our share funded is just really bad. So that's what I want to talk about.
Any other thoughts? No, this is an open forum. Representatives from several school districts in this area of responsibility have been invited, and we've been told we can talk about, you know, anything that's important and critical to our district. So it's a good opportunity to get his ear. Whether or not something comes of it, there's no guarantees. But, you know, he's a pretty powerful politician in the state, so by having his ear, that's always really useful.
So
lots of different politicians have different versions of the formula. One example I can give, the governor's proposal on the table would get our district a whole lot more money, but they haven't spelled out yet whether the additional money just goes to tax relief or whether it actually comes into our schools. Our position is we don't want all the money. We'd like our community to get tax relief as well. We'd just like to get up to adequacy and funding, and that extra money would do lots of wonderful things for our students. But no one has spelled out that if that goes through, and that's a question of whether or not it's even going to happen, what happens with the money?
Yeah, but the school board governor absolutely does not support from our students from because it would take away from someone that is out of the district. So these equations and formulas that we start reading them, it's really who gets the money, so everybody's obviously wanting money. And which formula to use. That's really where I think, as we just obviously need to say, we need to start funding what we're doing in the time period. And so along with this,
it's tricky because there are all these formulas, all these plans are very political. And I mean, I know as a school board member, I try to stay nonpartisan on my school issues. So it's a little bit tricky. And every school board member has their own politics, and every board has its own politics. So school boards tries to kind of represent all the school boards, but when they issue a statement, it doesn't necessarily reflect every school board or every school board member.
Mr. Martin?
Just a quick.
The popular opinion seems to be right now that until the dust settles from the next state gubernatorial election, that's the right gubernatorial, that probably nothing is going to go through. They're going to wait and see who ends up in power, and then something will go through. Mr. Biden? follow up email with all the metrics we gave him last time, and hopefully he shared it somewhere with someone. So that would be great.
Federal
email stuff taken care of in September, cut over October 1, and during October, maybe we can find another time to do some training on the Google Docs, so you understand how Google Docs work, so that if you want to try to do it, maybe Chromebooks can do that. I also checked with Chris to see if he might have enough spares around that he could assign the board members to say he could do that. And he thought he could pull out enough from his closet that he might be able to get. If you're interested in signing that out, I'd love, obviously, to use Blue for the board business. So he's working on that as well. So I'm trying to get the to use Blue.
That's
what
I was talking about. Just resetting.
Right, you were talking about.
Part of the district.